He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
And we're celebrating that wonderful fact today. Please turn with me to 323 for our first song of celebration. Christ the Lord is risen today. Service is just a little bit different today than it is normally, and so we will go directly into a scripture reading. And we'll be looking at Matthew chapter 27, but as you're turning there, let me proclaim again, but this time, what if we were in the first community church of Ephesus in the first century? What would my greeting to you have been? Well, it would have been this, we think. Christos Anesti. Christ is risen. Now, we're not doing tongues in here, but how would you like to learn just a little bit of Greek? Just a little bit. So if I said to you, Christos Anesti, he is risen, what would you say back to me? Well, you would say, indeed, he is risen. And in Greek, that sounds like Aletos Anesti. You want to try that? Aletos Anesti. So, Christos Anesti.
Aletos Anesti.
Excellent. Excellent. He is risen indeed. Okay, Matthew chapter 27, beginning at verse 62. The next day, that is, after the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said, Sir, we remembered how that impostor said while he was still alive, after 3 days, I will rise. Therefore, order the tomb to be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples go and steal him away and tell the people he is risen from the dead, and the last fraud will be worse than the first. Pilate said to them, You have a guard of soldiers. Go, make it as secure as you can. So they went and made the tomb secure by sealing the stone and setting a guard. Now after the Sabbath, Toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead, and behold, he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. See, I have told you." So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me."
Amen. Okay. Amen.
That doesn't set your spiritual juices flowing, what will? If you don't mind at this point, take your bulletin. Let's take a look at a couple of announcements here. First of all, it is our great pleasure to welcome the Hollis family into church membership. And, well, let's see, we have one. represent your family. Stand up. Stand up. And for anybody else that's interested in church membership, grab one of the elders or the pastor and be happy to talk to you about it. Today, since we are celebrating Resurrection Day, there will be no evening services tonight. A great time to be with family. The nursery schedule is available for April, And if you're interested in being a nursery worker, by all means, please see Betsy Dinger. Betsy, where are you? Oh, there we go. So Betsy would love to talk to you if you are interested in working in the nursery. And last but not least, the Ladies' Precept Bible Study resumes this Friday, 9:30, right here. And Karen, you guys still going over
Minor Prophets?
Okay, excellent. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, as we come before you today, we just rejoice in the fact that our Lord, your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, in the greatest event in all of history, died for us and was resurrected from the dead. And Lord, we're overwhelmed with emotion as we think of your love, at your mercy, at your grace. We, Lord, are amazed at the degree to which you would be willing to go to redeem lost humanity, to redeem each one of us individually. So we worship you and we praise you and we thank you this morning. And we look forward to the day when our Lord, the Lord Jesus Christ, will return as conquering king to reign on his universe. And for these events, Lord, we praise you and we thank you. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Amen.
As the weeping stood to leave, how could it be? How could it be? At noon, some said he died too soon. How could it be? How could it be?
Give us an opportunity for us to sing together ourselves. Christ Arose, a great classic Easter Resurrection Sunday hymn. Please stand with me as we sing. A little slower and a little quieter on the first verse.
Low in the grave he lay, Jesus.
seated. For our second scripture reading, let me encourage you either to grab your Bible and turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 15 or follow along on the screen. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and beginning at verse 1. Paul writes, "Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas and then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me, for I am the least of the apostles, unworthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we preach, and so you believed. Now if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain, and your faith is in vain. We are even found to be misrepresenting God, because we testified about God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if it is true that the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Then those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in Christ we have hope in this life only, we are of all people most to be pitied. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, Amen. The first fruits of those who have fallen asleep.
Amen.
Amen.
If I could ask the men to come forward for the offering, please. Well, we're going to take volunteers. So, Brian. And let's go to the Lord's Prayer for this as well. Heavenly Father, thank you again for the great privilege of worshiping you. We recognize before you today that giving is an act of worship, and we pray, Lord, that even in this, that we might glorify you, that you may take pleasure in our worship. We do ask, Lord, that you would be pleased to use the minimal things that we return to you for your glory and for your honor. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
This next song is one that you've heard because we've done it on Resurrection Sunday before, but it's not one in our hymnals. So Karen and I are going to be singing the first two verses, and then we're going to ask you to join on the third. So Julie will play a little prelude after that second verse, and you'll see a slide that reminds you to stand and sing with us. With us in song this morning. You may be seated.
Well, good morning. Let me welcome you to our service together today. It's great to see you here. Take your Bibles, please, and find 1 Corinthians 15. Corinthians chapter 15 is a passage that I've chosen to look at this morning on this day. I've enjoyed the singing, the music, the celebration so far of Christ, our Savior's resurrection. 1 Corinthians 15 is all about the resurrection. If I could highlight verse number 12, we read it earlier, but the scripture proclaims, "Now if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say there is no resurrection of the dead?" This is the correction that Paul gives to the church at Corinth. You know, this church was a group of believers. They were saints. They were sanctified ones. But they were not without their share of issues. And so much of this letter is corrective here. As we come to chapter 15, he really does want to highlight and correct this concept that there are some who said there's no resurrection of the dead. And so I want us to think this morning about how much accuracy matters. accuracy matters. Anyone involved in accounting knows that if you get one number wrong or do one computation wrong, everything else that is based on that number or that answer is also wrong. Mathematics, the same thing is true. Years ago, I had a visual illustration of this concept when I lived in Tennessee. Scales Mountain was the largest peak in Murfreesboro there in Tennessee, south of Nashville. And it was on the property of the camp that I worked at. We had plans to construct a lodge on the top of Scales Mountain. Scales Mountain was accessible via a road up until 200 or 300 feet below the peak. And the building was to rest right on the peak of this mountain. And so a road had to be built to get to the top for service trucks and equipment to build the lodge. Now, in the early days and the early stages of this, only a very capable four-wheel drive vehicle would go up to the top because it was straight up the side of the mountain. And so once the surveying was done, it was scheduled to have a series of switchbacks back and forth to get to the top. I believe there were 7 switchbacks at all. But after they had blasted with dynamite and used bulldozers and earth movers to get the first 1 or 2 lanes built, they realized that they had made an error in the lowest degree. And had they continued with this, where the top of the road was supposed to be, it would not even be on land. And so they had to start over with the road from the bottom. Because accuracy matters, right? One small degree or number or decision or outlook or belief can destroy so many other positive things. It's really the way that I'd like for you to see 1 Corinthians chapter 15. The error was that they were denying an actual resurrection of the dead. Well, I'm amazed in the scripture that this is not the only issue with the resurrection. Paul addressed in Timothy 2 other individuals who had claimed that the resurrection had already occurred, that it was already in the past, that there was nothing to look forward to, that the resurrection had already occurred. And so these are some areas that we can really err with the idea of the resurrection. We can deny that it is going to take place. We can say that it is past already. Or there's another way that we can hurt ourselves while thinking about the resurrection. And that is this. We either isolate it to a long ago event of Christ being raised from the dead and leaving it there, or we can isolate it to a future, one day down the road event and isolate it there. The resurrection needs to be part of our daily lives. In fact, I think if we think about it in this light, it is easily discernible, easily accessible in this passage of Scripture. Now, there are 58 verses. I understand. Yes, I am going to try to deal with all 58 today, but not in the way you think, because I normally take one verse and we just keep going verse at a time. We're going to fly over this chapter, and I have 6 or 7 things here, but they're straightforward from the passage. They are a simple summary of what Paul is getting at, because if we don't have the resurrection right, as verses 12 through 19 attest, we're in sad shape. You recall this passage of Scripture in chapter 15, verses 12 through 19. He reminds us that if there is no resurrection from the dead, not even Christ is raised. And if Christ is not raised, we are messengers of a false message. We're false witnesses. If Christ did not raise from the dead, the God that we proclaim to love and serve and speak for, He Himself is not a truthful or accurate God. There are other things. Our lives are empty and meaningless. Our preaching and our faith is in vain. And worst of all, we're still in our sins. So the resurrection is central. It is crucial. It is key. And it must not be relegated to a day long ago or one day in the future. We must see the resurrection of Jesus Christ as core and central to what we believe, because in fact it is. And so I would like to recommend to you a meditation of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, an ongoing meditation. I would like to encourage you to memorize 1 Corinthians 15. It needs to be, as it were, a playlist for every believer, all of it. Not just the passages that we know so well. Not just the end that we hear so often on Easter services, but the parts that we're not as familiar with, because all of it gives to us truths that can help us in our lives right now. Yes, Christ has risen from the dead. Yes, there is going to be a resurrection, but the resurrection is so much more than a long ago or a one day in the future event. Paul wants us to see it is crucial for every day of our lives. And so let's begin here with this passage of Scripture. And I want to remind us all of the first few verses, how that Paul deals with the gospel. He reminds them. You know, as pastors, as preachers, as teachers of the Word, even in an educational system, teaching in itself, there is a great danger and a great error that we must avoid, and that is the assumption that you get what we're teaching the first time completely, and you don't lose any of it, and you immediately go out and implement it into your lives, right? There's the repetition. There's the reminding. And much of Scripture is a reminder. And that's what Paul says he has to do here. I remind you of the gospel that is of utmost and firstmost importance to us. As we think about the death, I'm always amazed as leading up to Easter, as I read through the gospels and the scriptural accounts of how much unbelief and disbelief and discouragement and a lack of awareness of the very words of Jesus that was involved in his closest followers, Mary and the others. What were they doing on resurrection morning? They were going to the tomb with spices to anoint the body. What were the others doing? They were told that we have seen the Christ, and yet they didn't believe them. Is Luke 24, verses 10 and 11. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles, but these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. Now, it's one thing to be in that moment where there is great confusion and anticipation of who Christ is. The two disciples on the road to Emmaus, sir, we believed that he was the one, and yet now it's been 3 days since he died. Though Jesus rebukes them and corrects them, his ultimate goal is to get them to understand who he truly is and what he's truly done for them. My concern is not so much that we are at one time unaware fully of what the resurrection is or what it means, but that we get to that point. And we get to that point through the work of the Holy Spirit and the Word of God being a regular part of our lives. And so sometimes we need the constant reminder of the truths of the gospel. It is in this passage that we are reminded that death is a result of sin. In order for there to be a resurrection, there has to be a death. And death, we know, is a result of sin. It is the judgment of God. This death that we have faced since the beginning, and all of us, as the years go by, get closer to that day, that appointment that we are to face with death. It's just a reminder that for all these years, death has been the enemy, brought about by Adam in the garden, passed upon all men. And yet Christ here died. Now, this is the beauty of the gospel. And I, for years, you know, just reading through this passage, it's like, why start with the gospel? Why does he, he's talking about the resurrection. Why does he start with the gospel? Because the resurrection is the key concept to understanding the gospel. The first question is, there was a resurrection of Christ. Well, why did he die? He had done nothing wrong. Even Pilate himself admitted by the washing of his hands and the report of his wife, I've suffered many things because of this man in a dream this day. Have nothing to do with this. Pilate washes his hands and says, I find nothing wrong with this man. That Christ, there was nothing to hold him. Death had no power over him because he was innocent. He was righteous. Everything that he had done was pleasing to the Father. And so why did he die? And this is the message of the gospel. Christ died for our sins.
Amen.
And one of the reasons that we must continually preach the gospel to ourselves and have the resurrection in our minds on a daily basis is because the enemy wants to convince us that we have to try harder, that we're not going to measure up before God the way that we are. We blew it. We shouldn't have thought that. We shouldn't have acted in that way. I responded in the flesh, and now I'm ashamed, and now I wonder what my standing is before God. All of us have probably fought with doubt and discouragement in the Christian life because we've allowed the concept that in order to be right with God, I have to be right before God. I have to be good. I have to be perfect. I have to be sinless. I have to be blameless. And I'm glad that you're here today, because in reminding ourselves of the gospel, it is clear, and I want to make it as clear as I can today, that the gospel is not what any of us do. It is what has already been done for us. Amen. It is because Christ died in our place. He died for our sins. He died where we should have.
Yes.
In other words, when we think about the cross, that should have been you and I suffering, hanging in shame, humiliation, not only before the people of the earth, but before the God of heaven, open, naked, our sins evident, and yet Christ took our place on the cross so that we could take his place in righteousness. Mm-hmm. That is the gospel message. Even Paul here declares, I am unworthy of this calling. You talk about the Hall of Fame. Would Paul ever see himself in a Hall of Fame or a greatest category? Yes. Greatest of all sinners. That's what Paul himself declared himself to be. The love of God knows no bounds, though. No matter who you are, no matter what you've done, there stands a wonderful message at the cross of Jesus Christ, and that is, whosoever is thirsty, let him come and drink of the water of life freely. Christ paid it all so you and I could be forgiven, could be redeemed, could be justified, could be God's child not because we are good, but because Christ, the perfect one, the righteous one, stood in our place. It's the great substitution of which the gospel reminds us of. He died for our sins. He was buried, and he rose again the third day, according to the scriptures. Not only that, but he was seen by a few individuals, and then by 500, and then he was continued to teach and to express himself to those that looked for him. Well, that is the first one. The resurrection, we must see it as a part of the gospel. If you know the gospel, this passage reminds us of two things. Number one, the gospel is delivered. It is given, it is proclaimed, and it is also received. So those who know the gospel, we must not keep it to ourselves. We have an obligation to speak it, to proclaim it. It is through the proclamation, the preaching, the deliverance of the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ that God has chosen. That is the way that he has chosen to save those who believe. And I say to you, those of you who hear the gospel, you have an obligation to receive it, to hear it as a first-timer. I remember the way the gospel came to me. I knew the gospel. I had grown up in church. I could recite the gospel message. But aside from the work of God, all of that is just knowledge in the mind. There came a time when God began working in my own heart, and I knew I was a sinner, guilty before God. And I did what any good boy would do, and that is I tried to clean up my life. I tried to get rid of those sins that were condemning me. I tried to make myself in a position so that I would be accepted before God. Well, it only got worse, and that's a good thing. And my eyes are only open to the truth that no matter what we do, we are already so far short of God's glory. We are all so guilty already. And that is when the gospel message was proclaimed to me, and I heard it like it was the very first time. Dan, you can't work yourself into a relationship with God. But God has already provided in his Son, Jesus Christ, everything that you need to be right with him. It's a matter of faith, and so it must be received. If you've not done that, that is your greatest step. It is an urgent step. It is a step that you must take. Well, he goes verses 12 through 19. He reminds us that we are, of all men, most to be pitied if in this life we hope only in Christ. But not only that, but the resurrection is a guarantee of our forgiveness. He died, he was buried, he is risen for us. And because of that acceptance, God has forgiven us. John chapter 20, verse number 17, Jesus says to her, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father." But listen to the message he gives. "Go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and to your Father, to my God and to your God." Listen, in Christ, all those who come by faith, believing in him, have Christ as a brother. We are joint heirs with him. God is our Father, and he is not ashamed to call us likewise. The resurrection is a guarantee of our forgiveness. If Christ is not risen, then we're still in our sins, but he declares Christ has been raised from the dead, verse number 20. The resurrection is an indication of the first fruits of the great harvest. He tells us about this in verses 20 and 21, that Christ is raised and he is the first fruits of those who've fallen asleep. When will this take place? Well, the scriptures here tell us at his coming. And I'm not going to take a lot of time with this because in the coming weeks in our evening series on eschatology, we have come to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. So we're going to break this down in more detail as we study those things. But I do want you to remember that it is at his coming that we will be raised. He says that there is order. Verse 23, each in his own order, Christ the first fruits, then at his coming, those who belong to Christ. But I will remind you at this point that John chapter 5, Jesus said these words, "Do not marvel at this, for an hour is coming when all who are in the tombs will hear his voice and come out. Those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of judgment." Now, this is that warning why your urgent step is accepting Christ if you have not done that. If you are convinced that you can work or buy or earn or merit your way into heaven and into God's family, there's coming a day when God has determined that Jesus Christ is going to judge all mankind. And those who've not taken Christ as their Savior, by faith, repented, and believed, are going to be resurrected to a judgment. This is not just a resurrection of believers in Christ, but there is coming a day, Jesus said, when all who are in the tombs will hear the voice, will come out, and either go into the resurrection of life or the resurrection of judgment. So this is important. It is also in this passage, beginning verse 20 on through 28, that he reminds us that the evidence, the resurrection, is an evidence of Christ's reign. We know that after 3 days, Christ was raised from the dead, and then after 40 days, he ascended to the Father. The scriptures remind us all throughout the New Testament that Christ is exalted and is seated on the right hand of God. This is repeatedly taught throughout the New Testament that Christ is reigning now. And yet in these passages here, beginning at verse number 25, it reminds us that Christ is reigning as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, but he hasn't yet subdued all things. Now, Hebrews again reminds us of this. There are places in the New Testament that tell us Christ is supreme, he is exalted, he is at the right hand of God, but there are yet a few things that he has not quite subdued. Death is one of them. And so in the end, the last enemy we're reminded that will be defeated is death. And then God will deliver this world, the kingdom that he has subdued all powers and all authorities and all rebellions and all enemies under his feet. And he'll submit the whole thing to the Father. It's a wonderful truth. We find the evidence of Christ's reign, that Christ is ruling and reigning. If this is true, then allow Romans 8 to remind you of some wonderful things. What shall we say then to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. We have a Savior who is alive, who is seated at the right hand of God, making intercession for us. And my suggestion each day is that I live in light of that. But I don't allow the distractions and the discouragement and the defeated aspect of this, the world, the society around us, Satan, who wants to rob us of joy and peace and power that God promises to give to us. Remind ourselves that we have the one who is King of all kings and Lord of all lords, our advocate, seated at the right hand of God, and is there to make intercession for us. And who's going to condemn when he's the one who died for our sins? It might look like something along these lines. When Satan or your friend or enemy want to remind you of your actions and say you are unworthy, just go before the throne with that and hear Christ say, "What is that? What sin are you talking about? I died for that sin. I paid the price for that sin. You, my son, you, my daughter, you're forgiven. Now go, sin no more." Our days would be different if we had that outlook. It's for this reason that we remind ourselves of the gospel. Well, the resurrection is the basis for our sanctification. Have some fun. Begin in verse 29 and read about being baptized on behalf of the dead. Don't allow yourself to go too far with concepts. Paul is not promoting this. He is simply mentioning this as another evidence that there is something to life after this life. There are responses. In fact, if you go down through there, why do we suffer? Why do we live the way we do if there is no after tomorrow? Eat, drink, enjoy life, party, collect all the toys you want, because in the end, we all die, and that's the end. That's the point Paul is saying. This is no good. That's not the way it works. There is life after death, and we ought to live in sanctification. He reminds us there at the end of this that you wake up, verse 34, from your drunken stupor, as is right, and do not go on sinning. For some have no knowledge of God. I say this to your shame. Stop living in sin and begin being a light and a witness to those around you. Well, the resurrection is a model of our future bodies. This is where the passage, very seldom do you hear these passages read and discussed. And it is unfortunate. Verse 35 through verses 49, he simply reminds us that what we are going to be resurrected in is not this same body. It's not just another life in the same body. What is sown in the ground arises similar but different. There's continuity here, but there's also a discontinuity here, because he reminds us that we die in weakness, yet the body that will be raised is raised in power. We lay this body down in dishonor, and yet it'll be raised up again in glory. Amen. What is sown in the earth is earthly. What is raised is heavenly. The natural is laid aside. The spiritual is risen. We die in corruption. We will be raised in incorruption. He reminds us in verse number 49, just as we have borne the image of the man of dust, Adam, we shall also bear the image of the man of heaven, the second Adam, with the greater Adam, Jesus the Christ. Born in the likeness of Adam, raised in the likeness of Christ. Well, the body here is something to look forward to, because as we get older, I don't have to tell you that the body decays, that the body gets old, that the eyes go dim, the fingers stop responding the way they once did. The back's a bit bowed, not as erect as it once was. And life happens. The gray hairs come, and we lay this body down. But there's coming a day when it'll be raised, and it'll be in the power and the likeness of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. What a wonderful truth to remind ourselves of. Don't get down. Don't be discouraged. Meditate on this passage and look forward to the day when you'll get a new body. And by the way, which brings us to verse number 50. Not all of us will lay down this life in death and decay. Paul gives to us a mystery here. Not all will sleep or die. It's a concept that is borne out as well in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. When Christ appears, when He comes in power and glory, then the resurrection will occur first. But then those who are alive at His coming will be transformed, translated, will be changed into the likeness of His glorious body. What a wonderful concept this is. The evidence here is that you and I may be alive when that day takes place. Now, that's enough to stir any day out of the doldrums and out of the gutters into a day of joy and delight and anticipation. Amen. That we'll have our vision, that we'll have strength. There will be no more dying, no more pain, no more sickness, no more sorrow. We'll awake in His likeness. Well, the resurrection here is seen as the climax of His coming as well. The dead will be raised incorruptible. The living will be transformed. But one more thing, the resurrection here is presented as motivation for daily living. Look, it's not in vain. It's not as they say, just live for today because tomorrow we all die. He reminds us here in verse 58, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. Listen, it'll all be worth it one day, and it'll be worth it one day soon. Whether we go by the grave or whether we go by the transformation and the resurrection and the transformation when Christ appears, we have a better day, the greatest day. You know, your best life now? No. You want to keep living in this body another 50 years? Yeah. Not on your life. Think about these things and allow the resurrection not to be something of years ago or perhaps many years in the future, but because Christ is risen from the dead and because He is for us and we have His Spirit indwelling us, our best days are to come. Amen. But we can enjoy life now, reminding ourselves of these truths about the resurrection. Mm-hmm. Father, thank You again for our time today. I pray that Lord, You would, not only today as a day of celebration, as the day of recognition of Your resurrection, but each day of our lives, remind us of the gospel that You died so that we wouldn't have to, and You were raised for our justification. And as You have given to us Your Spirit, we can walk in a new life, and we can walk in power, and we can walk in victory. Help us to do that. Father, help us not to be discouraged when doubt and fear seek to rob us of our assurance. May we hear Jesus say, I have ascended to Your God and to my God, to Your Father and to my Father. Mm-hmm. He's simply gone to be with Dad, and we too will go to be with You one day. Father, we thank You for the truths that we will get a new body, a glorified body, a body that will not be set with sinful tendencies and sinful temptations, but we'll awaken to be in your likeness. And Father, help us each day to walk in a manner that's worthy of your calling. May we be truly steadfast and immovable and always abounding in the work of the Lord, because we know that one day we'll be rewarded for it. That day we may cast our crowns at your feet, because you alone are the one worthy. And it is because of your grace and your power, as Paul said here, that we live and we do and we serve as we have. And so we pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
As we close, let's turn to number 51. Sing the hymn, Alleluia, Alleluia, as our final praise together. But I hope you will continue to praise the Lord for what he's done for you. Let's stand together as we sing. Do not have evening service, but continue this celebration with your family tonight.